basically, the format that we're going to follow tonight is Jack Barker here is going to present a talk on that topic, followed by an open discussion session where people will be able to give their opinions and hopefully give some ideas for concrete actions that we can take to deal with the scourge and blight of inequality in our society. Just want to talk a little bit about the basic format of the discussion. We'll be having a first-time priority speakers list, and hope that everybody gets a chance, everybody who wants to speak will get a chance to speak. I'd like to also acknowledge our local Member of Parliament who's decided to join us tonight, Marie Rankin. Thank you very much. So, I'd like to introduce Jack. Jack is an environmental and social justice activist, originally from the UK, who emigrated to Canada 2 years ago. He was a member of Amnesty International and the Labour Party. And and since coming to Canada, he's become involved in various environmental and social justice campaigns. Groups like Creatively United, Vancouver Island Green Scene, and the Farmland Protection Coalition, Social Coast, the BCNDP, and obviously the Social Environmental Alliance. Quite simply, he believes in a much more egalitarian and sustainable society that works for everyone and not just a privileged few. So I'd like you all to welcome Jack. And
hello. My name is Jack, and just to let you know from the start, I do have a, if I can manage to get the words out, that I do have a stutter. So, well, there it is. Sorry, I didn't plan that. That's what that is, if that happens. I'm here today to talk to you about the growing gap amongst the rich and the rest of us, commonly known in politics as income inequality. This is a problem which I am very passionate about, and I hope tonight that my passion will spread to you after you've heard what I have to say. And just to let you know as well, my speech will be made available on the Social Environmental Alliance website in the next few weeks as well, and complete with all my references. Love this. Another word I could use there. This is my first time talking to this large number of people for this amount of time, but it's okay because right now you're all naked in. Thank you. income inequality is the definition is how evenly or unevenly income is distributed in a country. Since the Occupy movement highlighted the issue of the 99% it has changed how we view the economy as well as it's now a crucial talking point in most Western nations as well. So just to give an example, Barack Obama called it the defining issue of our time, and Jack Layton and the NDP here in Canada, they also they began to talk about it, and in the UK as well, the leader of the Labour Party, Ed Miliband, has made income inequality his mission for when he gets into power as well. And so there have actually been some kind of inequality of income in various ways for a long time. The current the situation it began to get a lot worse in the 1980s in most Western nations. And so I just want to now, I want to tell you some statistics on income inequality, which hopefully will make you angry and will alarm you. So I have loads. I probably won't actually read them all out, but to begin with, I think the one which angers me the most, right now, the richest 85 people in the world have as much combined wealth as the poorest half of the world. Which, yeah, it's ridiculous. The richest 10% of the world own 90% of all assets. Whilst the poorest poorest 70% and just 3% of the world's assets. In America, 95% of all the income gained from 2009 and 2012 went to the top 1% of earners. So this increase in income share, the top 1%, is at its highest level since the eve of the Great Depression. Here in Canada, amongst those under the top 10%, there was virtually no change in real income growth from 1982 to 2010, whereas the top 0.01%, they saw a jump of 160%. So, and I'll just actually give you one last one. In Canada, in the late 1920s, the average chief executive was making 25 times the average worker. In 1995, chief executives earned an average of 85 times the amount of the average worker, whereas today's chief executive, on average, makes roughly 250 times. So, and you know, there's no evidence to suggest that today's chief executives are more talented, productive, or hardworking than the 1920s counterparts. And, you know, not 10 times more productive anyway. So, yeah, so that's another one. With the highest rate of poverty as well. So, you know, I'm talking globally, yet I'm also talking about it here as well. So it's happening right underneath our noses, you know? So, for the last three decades, the tables of the super rich have overflowed with hardly any scraps falling off for the rest of us. You know, for too many people, the gains from growth happen somewhere else for someone else. And it's time to spread the wealth from the privileged few to the many. So now I want to talk about the danger to the democracy of Canada as well as a result of the extreme income inequality. So it's about an increasing power and influence over the government. It's about how the wealthiest groups and individuals can capture political power at the expense of the rest of us. So a few examples of how they exert their influence are through massive campaign contributions, the writing of party platforms, the selection of candidates, the drafting and mending of legislation, and the shaping of public opinion through the think tanks and media ownership, like Mr. Rupert Murdoch and Fox News, of course. So as wealth has accumulated at the top, taxes have actually been reduced on the wealthy, and tax loopholes have been created as a result of their lobbying. A significant share of the income of the rich, like capital gains, are taxed at a much lower rate than the income from the regular wages. So this is a danger, as it means the government increasingly works for 1% and not for the working people of the country. As the American lawyer Louis Brande once said, we can have democracy or we can have great wealth concentrated in the hands of the few. We cannot have both. So one of my other passions is also climate change, and so as we try to urge people towards climate justice, one of the key things preventing that is inequality, as it undermines the trust that we are all in this together. You know, none of us wants to think that we are making massive efforts to reduce our own carbon emissions, only to have the wealthy to buy their way out of the changes they have to make. So climate justice research shows that a Canadian household carbon emissions are highly unequal, with the wealthiest 20% of Canadian income. Canadian income earners have almost double the carbon emissions of those in the poorest 20%. This means that even if the richest Canadians were to reduce their household emissions by 30% by 2020, they are still emitting more than the poorest 20% of households they do today. So income inequality isn't just a moral problem, it's also a practical one in terms of trying to get to a carbon neutral country. So Richard Wilkinson and Kate Pickett, they are the authors of a book. The name is The Spirit Level, that shows how many of damaging effects as a result of income inequality have shown that societies with less equality are also more open to embracing environmental actions. Moving on to health and economic issues, Wilkinson and Pickett also show that extreme income inequality has a clearly negative effect on a wide range of health and social and economic problems too. So less equal countries have more mental health problems, higher infant mortality rates, reduced life expectancies, and less social cohesion as well. So the effects are most pronounced at the lower end, but they are evident throughout the country as well. So the fact is that more equal societies are not only better for the poor and the sick, but they're also more prosperous as a whole. And when I say prosperous, I'm talking about increasing the wider good, not just the GDP. So the Nordic countries with the highest taxes on the rich have the smallest equality gap and the highest living standards as well. So in order to understand the possible solutions, let's have a look at the causes. So as I mentioned earlier, the situation it began to get worse in many rich nations in the 1980s. So in the UK, when Margaret Thatcher came to power, and also Ronald Reagan in America as well. So Thatcher brought in tax policies that favoured the rich, making millions unemployed as well, and meaning that the percentage of households in poverty may be an important part of the reason why inequality increases. research from 2012 concluded that roughly 15% of the gross of the growth in income inequality in Canada through the 1980s and 1990s was directly linked to falling rates of unionization. In Canada, the proportion of workers represented by unions in 1984 was 42%, and that was when it was at its peak. So for 2011, it was only 31%. So, since 1982, governments in Canada have amended labour laws more than 64 times in ways that restrict the ability of the unions to organise. More laws restricting labour rights than at any other period in the history of Canadian labour relations, and with Harper in charge of the country bringing in aggressive policies that favour his corporate chums and the wealthy, such as further legislation that curbs workers' employment rights, then income inequality will only increase. A professor of economics at Queen's University actually told Canada's House Finance Committee that Canada's tax system is designed to exacerbate inequality. Okay. So with the super rich having an increasing power and influence over the government, increased corporate lobbying and the donations, and more right-wing mongering from the likes of the Sun News, lower taxes on the wealthy, and Harper restricting the ability of the unions to organise, they've all resulted in extreme income inequality. So this has meant no real change in real income growth for the rest of us, higher mental health problems, less social cohesion, and no chance of any real action on vital issues like climate change. It is a gross injustice and a waste to human potential. It is socially corrosive and divisive. So without a concerted effort to tackle income inequality, the cascade of privilege will continue down the generations, and equality of opportunity will be just a dream for all the evidence shows that greater equality provides foundation on which higher social well-being can improve. So my words, I knew they wouldn't come out exactly as planned, but I have a voice and I intend to use it and to keep on using it. Conversation tonight. It will continue, and I urge you all to do the same, to raise awareness about the gap with the 1% and the rest of us, which will only actually get worse if we don't start to do anything about it. The majority of Canadians, they think income inequality makes the country less fair. We just have to keep reminding them of the facts. The consequences and the causes. So now we're able to open it up to the audience and talk about the possible solutions that we can take here in Canada to bring about a more equal country. Income inequality has, it didn't actually just happen, it's resulted from political choices. Well, now it's time for new choices. So I just want to say thank you for coming and listening as well.
Though, obviously, if you're not outraged, you're probably not paying attention. And I think that at this point, what I'd like to hear is your perspectives on this issue and some of the potential ways that we can actually deal with the issue, address it, and proactively move forward on it. I'm going to be taking a speaker's list. Bear with me, I don't know everybody's name, but I'll let everybody have a chance to speak, hopefully. So, moving right along. Yes, you, sir.
Okay. Murray Rank, and I just want to say thank you, Jack, and thank you, Social Environmental Alliance. This was brilliant. It was really wonderful that you pulled this off. You know, you asked us, Sasha, to talk about solutions, and I just want to have three in mind. But before I do, when you use the word social cohesion, I think we all feel what's happening to Canada. We don't need statistics, although they were brilliant. We know, we can feel what's changed in my lifetime. Since the 1980s, you talked about it's getting worse, and we all, I think, experienced that. Three things I think that can be dealt, that we should focus on. One is tax reform. There was a report done in the early 70s by Carter that had the famous slogan, a buck is a buck is a buck. And you use the example, Jack, of capital gains. But all tax income should be treated the same, so we don't privilege a certain group that have the ability to use investments and dividend gross-ups and all the fancy things that the telephone book-style income tax allows only certain people to take advantage of. I think that's one fundamental reform. Second thing is something I've been working on in the Finance Committee, where that Queen's Prof came, and I was there when he said that, is we need to go after people in tax havens. We've got between $5 and $8 billion a year that's hemorrhaging to tax havens, and the government is not taking that seriously. The third thing is the terrible statistics about trade unions. The fact is, if you took out the public sector unions in your statistics, it would be even more brutal. The people in the private sector are just not unionized anymore in Canada, and that's why we cannot catch up. We cannot, that gap everybody talks about that you described so brilliantly is just getting worse and worse. So Jerry Diaz and Unifor, God bless them, they're talking about some serious techniques to try to get some of the workers in the retail sector organized, the young and so forth. That's a start, but we really have to empower trade unions once again. Those are the three things that I think sort of lend themselves to some of at least grappling toward a solution to the issue.
Well, the subject of finance, and I think also our federal government could do something about the Bank of Canada. It's costing the taxpayer of Canada $170 million every day of the week. Every day of the week, just to pay the interest on our federal and provincial loans. $170 million every day of the week. No wonder we can't afford any social programs. I think it's high time that we had a political party that would stand up and say, yes, we will take control of the Bank of Canada. We will attempt to control the economy of our country. I think we should have a political party that is a socialist party. A party that is
here.
Party just had a meeting in Ottawa, and they decided to take socialism right out of the Constitution.
You mean the NDP?
The NDP,
yeah.
They did socialism right out of the Constitution. They don't want to be called socialists. Because I think it's high time that we would stand up and be called a socialist.
Thank you.
I'm glad you did. That's amazing. I just wanted to touch on a couple things that your wonderful, amazing talk made me think about. One of the reasons that the Nordic countries operate as efficiently as they do is there are already certain measures of equality in those countries that we don't have, and that is 54% of their parliaments are female. Mm-hmm. There are some really tangible things we can do to have social cohesion, and one of them is to create issues that affect everybody. Mm-hmm. And women's equality affects everybody, and we are way not equal in this country. Income equality, once it's gendered, it's a way more sad state of affairs. Mm-hmm. And what I see happen again and again is those in power talk about, if we take the Harper government, for example, because they're an easy target, but it's actually a system that's gone on for generation after generation, is that job creation tends to focus on a group of people, for instance, the oil sands, shipbuilding, jet fighters. Those will significantly employ males, young males. They'll take them out of their homes into other parts of Canada to work. Pay them exorbitant amounts of money, but that doesn't do anything for women. It doesn't do anything for the 28% of our family dynamic in Canada that's now single parents. 95% of those are females living under poverty. So I'm thinking we also need to, as a society, think about what could be a business model for us to look at that could do something about women's equality, but also help families and men, because we know when we talk about women's issues that a lot of people tune out. So I'm thinking universal daycare. It gives families a leg up. It gives low-income families, and in specific single moms like myself, somewhere that their children are safe, that's affordable, subsidized, and they could go out and work and have that equal access to jobs. It also gives our social workers jobs that pay well. It's government jobs with benefits, which social workers are grossly underemployed in this country. It just creates a different stream of income that will work towards equality for families, equality for women, and safe, happy environments for our kids. So I think in terms of social cohesion, We need issues that make sense to everyday people. And we will talk about taxes till the end of time. But it's just, it becomes almost gibberish at some point to most people. It's like, yeah, taxes, that's the way it is. I'm thinking a plan that employs a lot more women at good paying wages and is, has somewhere that our kids can go every day, will enforce families and all different kinds of families. When I say family, I'm not referring to necessarily man, women, heterosexual. I just want to be clear that families look like all kinds of things, but we need an issue that's going to get to the heart of everyday people, everybody's lives. So that was my
I'd just like to continue the trend by staying seated. I just want to sort of touch on what you have brought up a bit earlier about the socialist bit. The rule I like to play, the card anyway, is that you can't, and I'm waiting for an engineer to actually tell me wrong, but you can't fix what's broken if the tools you have are also broken. And so when we talk about how we don't have sort of a socialist party where they've taken it out for the various reasons that they did, it sort of jumps on what I want to talk about, which is we can't really come together and talk about these problems, especially in the mainstream, because so often it's PR and image management that takes precedent. And so you get these things. So despite, although what we're talking about tonight is very substantive and has this quite a bit to talk about in terms of policy, and there's quite a bit of debate to have there, that doesn't seem to what makes it on CBC. That's certainly not what comes out of O'Leary's mouth or Rex Murphy. And so you get all these pundits, and they sort of create this public sphere, and that's what a lot of people draw their information from. It might be waning because of the internet, but ultimately, it's that we can't come together and have a very adult topic about it. So now, when somebody trots out the word like socialist, a lot of people go, "Oh, I don't want to get involved in that because that's moving to an area I'm not comfortable with." And so we've been able to control these perceptions, and it keeps us from having an actual substantive debate.
We have to step out from all isms. We have to recognize that we're all the same. We're all alike. There's no difference between us, actually, fundamentally, in the universe. Hi, everybody. But I so appreciate this dialogue is like so important that we're all here tonight. Thank you, Jack. Thank you so much. Yeah.
You, sir?
Yes. First of all, thanks, Jack. That was a great speech. So there's an elephant in the room right now. I'll just say it: capitalism. Basically, what we've been talking about thus far is just symptoms of a systemic problem. And yes, reforms are very necessary and very helpful, but ultimately they're just reforms within a framework that is reinforcing all of these symptoms that require reform. And they're never, ever, if you look at the history of capitalism, it's a history of undulating reforms, up and down, up and down. And it will keep going like that, on and on and on, and so we start thinking about what the two gentlemen up front were talking about, which is system change. And we do need to stop being so scared of words like capitalism, socialism, revolution. And because the way I see it and the way a lot of people see it is that capitalism is dying. It's in the coffin right now, and it's supposed to be buried. So, it's just a question, do we die with it, or do we transcend it? Because there's no other choice. And with that in mind, excuse me, if anyone's interested in some education about capitalism, there's a Marxist day school on Sunday at the university. It starts at 9 and goes till 4. It's free. And it's, I'll leave some pamphlets at the front.
Single mothers working, you know,
even though they work so hard, it's never enough to feed their family. And how the corporations, they make so much money, but they don't put it back into their employees or invest in them and encourage them. And so there were, you know, this one group who went to swim to go investigate how they do their, you know, like, job labor work of, you know, like the government funding and everything. And it was very different because the rich were taxed more, so they had higher income tax in their country. And like they asked, you know, is anybody without work? And the lady said that only if it's an immigrant who just came in the country, can't speak maybe English or Swedish, you know, but like everyone is covered, like universal health care for the children and the people. And the people were asked, are you happy paying higher taxes to have all this extra perks? They're like, oh yeah, I love paying taxes. And so you're kind of going to wonder, because there was the one woman, and she was crying, and her daughter was there too, consoling her. It was so heartbreaking. And how, you know, just creating jobs is not the answer, but like creating decent jobs that people can rely on. You know, they can pay your bills, buy your food, and whatever have you. So that's the other thing. It's, you know, do we want to mimic Sweden and other, other countries, like countries in Europe? And also like finding the solution that truly works for us in this, you know, kind of world, right? Yeah, I just wanted to put that out there.
Thank you. Let's see, I believe in Marxism they talk about the conditions for change. I use the word change rather than revolution. And I think that we're very close to approaching exactly that. And I can say that safely, I think, because I think this movement versus the huge oligarchy, not in terms of numbers, but in its power, is now fairly close to, you know, its denouement or collapse. Not collapse, because they don't ever collapse. Oligarchies historically, despite whatever we might say, morph themselves time and time again, from aristocracies to whatever, to whatever, to whatever, and you can dress them up, but you know, in new clothes, but they're always the same, or take their whatever it is, they're still naked. Okay, so, but this particular time is unique in history, and I think that we're all aware of that, simply because the historical record shows that at this particular historical moment, the defining moment, unlike one we've ever been at before, because of the totality of the size of the communications ability, which has previously been not available to global sort of movements. One thing that always hamstrung Communist International coming out of a single nation, you know, solidly, you know, socialized and everything, was that it could not expand outside itself without sort of a bitter armed conflict. And this is the thing about this time is perhaps the absence of armed conflict or a major sort of huge armed conflict to precipitate a new sort of morphing of the oligarchy into its ugly, new ugly form, perhaps, we'll say. And that's really one of the keys I think I've understood from what I've picked up from some of the really top thinkers on these kind of things is in the language. And this comes out of study of Orwell. I've been through reading about, I've read extensively, we'll say, from writers. And the thing is to create not just a new way of speaking that exhibits none of the, you know, sort of buzzwords, the key things, you know, the gotchas, all this kind of stuff, and trying to create a new sort of dialogue that overcomes. That's what defeats, because that's what defeats all, any kind of sort of discussion. It's always the language, because the language and the things that they have or that this group has are irrefutable arguments, and you cannot argue with them. You cannot discuss them. Because they can always, you know, and the key phrase that they talk about is Tina. There is no alternative. And what they mean by that is that they're right. There is no alternative, because if you don't follow us, you're dead. And that's, you know, right. You know, that's what it is. What's your alternative? Death. And I'm serious. That's a very serious charge I'm making. I know that. But everybody knows that, you know, intuitively. Thank you.
It brings to mind a comment I heard the other day that the only thing worse than capitalist exploitation is being excluded from capitalist exploitation. you, sir, in the back of the glasses.
My name's Lee. I was a European Affairs journalist for most of the last 10 years in Brussels, so I'm quite familiar with some of the situation in Europe. And even in the Nordic countries, so I have to sort of disabuse some people, unfortunately, of some illusions here. Europe is no Shangri-La. The Nordic countries are also no Shangri-La. There has been increasing equality in all of the Nordic countries since the 1980s, no different from here. They started from a higher place, so it makes things look a little bit better, but let's not be under any illusion in that. That growth in inequality, those cuts of social programs, those declining wages, all the stuff that we've been talking about today, has been overseen as much by social democratic parties as by conservative parties. And we have to be very honest about this. So the discussion here tonight about, you know, Obama and, not that he's even a social democrat, he's just a democrat. Even the NDP, and I vote NDP, of course I do, but I want the knife halfway in my back instead of all the way in my back. Of course I do. I shouldn't be so cynical. I should be so cynical. But I've seen François Hollande, the socialist, social democrat leader of France, elected on a platform of anti-austerity, and within days of his election, commit to some of the most swinging austerity since that happened under Sarkozy. We have to be very honest about this, and it is not that social democrats are somehow venal or mean or evil people. We have to recognize that in the period of economic growth has happened basically between an unprecedented economic growth that happened between the 1940s and the 1970s, social democrats would share out the spoils a lot more fairly than the conservatives or Christian democrats would. They would still share out the spoils, but they just wouldn't do it quite as much as the social democrats. And today, in a period of stagnating growth, or just stagnation, or decline, social democrats will give us austerity light instead of pure austerity. And what we have to do is we have to leap over this and ask ourselves, what was it in the first place that gave us the welfare state that we had in Canada and Australia, New Zealand, and Western Europe, and the Nordic countries in the first place in the 1940s? And this was a period of about 30 years of revolutionary upheaval, of First and Second World War, of Holocaust. So that when the Second World War ended, both social democrats and conservatives said, if we do not give the people a modicum of demands, we don't give them pensions, unemployment insurance, education, healthcare, that's it, the game is over. So we have to build a movement that is as big as, and as scary, as threatening to elites as the movements that were built in the 1920s and 1930s. If I was a little critical of social democrats before, it is only because of my disappointment. What I know is that in the 1920s and 1930s and 1940s, it was communists and social democrats and anarchists and progressives with a movement that was so threatening through our strikes and organizations and importantly our trade unions, that they had no choice but to get this. And that's what we need again. we need to rebuild that. And everybody has been right here about talking about the elephant in the room. We do need to be talking about this, and it can't just happen in Canada. Because the minute that, I'd love, Murray, it would be fantastic if you could get through some tax reforms. I would love it if you could get through, what was the second thing that you said there?
Tax savings,
fantastic, absolutely wonderful. But at the minute that you begin to propose something like that, there will be capital flight and economic sabotage from Canada. And you will have to turn around within a few days or a few weeks at most. The only countries where there's been the possibility where they've managed to retreat in recent years is in South America, where for luck, there was, in a number of different countries at the same time, left-wing governments that pushed further and further to the left. And so there was a level of protection. But even there, they're still under enormous pressure from global markets, and it will not last long. It will be reversed if there is not a global change. We have to be talking about social justice at a global level. We cannot just be voting NDP. We have to be talking about transformative change. One last quick thing. It's interesting that the most developed analyses of these problems are not coming from the left at all, but they're coming from people like Thomas Piketty. He was a thoroughly mainstream MIT and then Université de Paris economist. Branko Milanovic, again, a World Bank economist. These people are saying, look, we can't, this inequality will continue to grow. It's inherent within capitalism. The only way that we can overcome this is some sort of global social democracy. That is, some sort of taxation, a minimal taxation at a global level. Otherwise, capital will just move to some other jurisdiction. This is the scale of ambition that we must be talking about.
That was really tough to follow. Thank you for saying all of that. I couldn't agree more with what you said. I'm just going to pick up on a couple of the things that Jack said that really stuck out for me, and something I think that in British Columbia we forget sometimes when we look at income inequality, that the most unequal province in Canada is the one that we live in. And it's also the province where we've had the highest rate of child poverty. I think we had a one-year pardon inside of 10 years in a generation. So I'm going to try and offer up a solution in a really short statement. So if you look at the body in British Columbia that's responsible for dealing with poverty and social welfare, it's the Ministry of Social Development and Innovation. Ministry of Social Welfare. Yeah, something like that. And anyway, if you take a look at their 2012-13 budget plan and their entire budget, it was just north of $2.3 billion. So that's what pays for the whole show for the body that deals with poverty. In 2012-2013, there was approximately just north of 140,000 recipients, or people who were dependent on the Ministry of Social Development to meet their basic daily needs. So if we look at that budget and state it another way, it's just under $19,000 per year for every single individual who receives assistance from the Ministry of Social Development. No one likes math, but I'm going to take it one step further. So a single recipient of welfare in British Columbia receives $610 a month if they're employable, which is $7,320 per year. If you're disabled, it's about $11,000. So we're still looking at, so from the bottom to the top, about $12,000 per person in administrative costs. So just to help someone go into the Ministry of Social Development, to the welfare office, get a check, pay for food for their family, and feed their children. $12,000, and that is $5,000 roughly more than they receive in just cash in their pocket. So this is quite a cowardly solution that I'm going to propose, because it's not destroying capitalism and it's not really taking on the system. But I'm going to say within that system, within the budget that we have, if we're save the taxpayers' money and pull yourself up by your bootstraps kind of society, which I don't believe we are, but that's what you need to say sometimes. I would say that a guaranteed annual income set at $12,000 or $7,000 beneath the administrative cost per person for helping someone on basic welfare, if we just allowed people enough money to survive in a way that was dignified, we'd find that people living in poverty could realize a lot more of their economic potential and be a great benefit to our society. And if you look at British Columbia over the same period I'm talking about, and I know I threw out a lot of math there, the CCPA did a study where it showed that the costs of poverty, cumulative, and that's health care, police, child welfare, etc., amounts to about $8.2 million. The budget for the ministry that deals with poverty is $2.3 million. My solution, guaranteed annual income, comes in at about $1.5. Just saying. It seems pretty simple to me. If you crunch the numbers, we don't even need a revolution to make sure that people live in poverty can live with some dignity and respect. And I think that's a pretty straightforward example of a solution. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm a little bit more radical. I'm all for a tax rule because they can't do anything without our money. So just for 1 month, don't pay a mortgage, don't pay your credit cards, pay your income tax a month late, don't pay your property taxes until a month later, and just see what it does, just to see, to follow the money. I also want to give an example of democracy as I've seen it. I travel to Costa Rica a lot, and this is a country that has 95% literacy rate, 96% voter rate, 96%, they're 100% covered for their medical. All their education is covered. If they want to be a doctor, it's completely and utterly paid for until the very end. And their infrastructure is better than ours. A third of their country is designated parkland that is tended to and cared for. The people that are unable to work due to issues of around them are given money to survive to buy. If there isn't enough money for them to buy what they need, people give it to them. And I've been examples of people just giving me stuff because I needed it. And you know why they can do this? Because they don't have an army. They're only one of two countries in the whole frickin' world beside Iceland that does not have an army. They do not spend war. They're not angry. They don't have an enemy. Yes. We would have enough money and enough people to do everything that needed to be done on this freaking planet.
Yeah.
And we would take care of each other without being angry. I'm sorry. Anyways, that's just where I'm going with that.
Comments on everything. I really like everything you said. Like, good job. What you said was great because in Utah they've reduced homelessness by 78% since the start of the millennium, and they did it not by a whole bunch of like tax increases, but they just gave people an apartment, the money they needed to live, and a social worker, and that evened out to less than the cost of your average homeless person's encounters with the police in the hospital. And I mean, it's just our way of thinking about things that leads to all these problems in the first place. We're also narrow-sighted and greedy and focused on ourselves that we don't realize that there's dozens of other people around us every single day that we walk past without giving any regard at all. And capitalism isn't really dying anytime soon because it's what people dedicate themselves to. It's the only thing they have to feed themselves, to clothe themselves, to shelter themselves. And until we can provide an alternative, that's just the way it's going to be. And I'm not much pleased at the idea. But, and so income inequality isn't, as Jack said earlier, it doesn't just happen. It doesn't just appear out of nowhere. It's the result of people who are given power looking at the whole situation, seeing the dozen people around them, and then they go, those two. I don't like those two. They're going to work for me for minimum wage, and I'm going to profit off of them. Now, that's a pretty simple analogy, but when it comes down to it in the end, that's what it is. For every, it's like Jack saying, the CEO earning 25 times more. and I don't know, but that just makes me really pissed off. Like Jack said, like, 85 people have the wealth of half of the world? Like, what? I don't know. Thinking about it on an international level, like this dude over here was saying, we need a new global movement of people who are ready to realize that the environment is in crisis, socially we're in crisis, economically we seem to be stuck in a recession that never ends, years and years on. Like, when are we gonna, everyone will just wake up one day and be like, oh crap, like that's not gonna happen, because we need to eat, and we need to drink, and we need to be inside. Like, so we need an alternative. We need a revolution, I guess, but just storming the Bastille isn't really going to do anything either, because it'll be a new set of faces. Like, I don't know.
Being aware is half of it. It's awesome.
Okay.
Hearing all these things, I had a young man over there who said everything that I wanted to say. I'm listening to everybody, and I'm so happy to see so many young people. That's wonderful.
Yes, it is.
Because you're going to take over from us. but we've got to think of how are we going to get all these things that we want? Whether the NDP would be able to, I don't think that they can do it as much as I would like to see them do. But a couple of things that I think that we need to do is, one thing is the unions. The unions have been co-opted. Yeah. The union labor leadership is not working for the general public. Sure, there are good union, small union leaders, but the general public, the general union leadership is not taking a stand and trying to get better wages for people. Why aren't they not out there trying to organize non-union people?
Hear, hear.
Yeah.
That's so important. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, I'm not afraid of taxes, and I think some of the people said that. I think we've got to somehow get to the public to point out that, sure, we have maybe lower taxes, but what about all the added fees that we have because of these lower taxes? And somehow we've got to get through to the public. And that's the other thing is, how do we get to the general public? You know, I mean, we're a very small group here. I mean, it's one of the biggest groups I've seen for a long time. Progressive things. But it's still small. And whether it's a sign that the young people are, you know, are, it's going to grow, I don't know. I don't believe capitalism is on its way out as much as I would love it to be. But that's it. And we've also got to somehow get people to vote. Yes. And that's important, whatever they believe.
My name's Rega Godrin, and I'm going to talk about poverty in a slightly different way. 400 years ago, my ancestors, the Plains Cree, we provide for ourselves, and we, you know, fished and had agriculture and hunted. And then my great-grandfather, Louis Gunn, he was living on the reserve, Cowessess, just outside of Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan. My grandmother was taken off reserve, and so my grandmother, mother, myself, we've been generations now of people who have received benefit from social programs because we've lost those tools that we had before to take care of ourselves, and we became recipients. And I grew up in Victoria, and I know Victoria is a place that it is very difficult to go hungry, and it is difficult to not have a place to live because there are, I mean, there is subsidized housing and there are shelters and programs. But my brother, he died homeless on the streets of Victoria. And he spent the last 6 months of his life living in Beacon Park. Before that, he lived in James Bay and he lived in the Niagara apartments. and he only got 15 hours a week working at Thrifty's, and that wasn't enough to pay his rent. And so my family, we actually didn't know that he was homeless until he died. My uncle's homeless now in Victoria. And so when I hear all these issues about inequality, I worked with a lot of anti-poverty groups, went to the National Anti-Poverty Organization's training school in Ottawa, Willis School for Action. And I've worked with, you know, TAPS and different organizations here in Victoria. And I got tired of lobbying government. I got tired of trying to make changes from the outside. I used to represent BC for the National Youth and Care Network, and when Matthew Beaudrell died at the hands of his mother and the Go Inquiry was called, I was able to make sure that the youth and care were a stakeholder in that process, and we were able to make sure that the rights of youth and care were put in the new act when it was redone. I ran for City Council in Victoria in 99, and then I moved away, and this is the first year I've been back during election year. So I am running for Victoria City Council this fall. So, I mean, one of the ways that I've talked to people, and I guess Yellowknife is an interesting example, because their city council, just as a blanket policy, when a building is built, there's a portion of that for subsidized housing. Just off, it's not even a question. They know when buildings are built, a portion of that is subsidized housing. So there aren't these ghettos. I lived in Blanchard Courts, now called Evergreen Terrace. Every building has people of lower incomes, and it's just you don't judge your neighbors by where they live, because your building has people of all different income brackets. So that's just one idea that I have, you know. Get at the table and you can help make some decisions. I'm Riga Godin. I have cards if anyone wants to.
TED Talks is a lot of fascinating ideas, but it's very weak, in fact, non-existent, about how to make ideas happen. Frida asked a key question: how do we make these things happen? I want to honor a number of people in the room: Zeb Keen, Murray, our wonderful MP, Marion Smarden, because they actually go listen to people at the doorstep. And until we're willing to do this, I don't think we're going to see anything happen.
To a computer, you know, 300 hours a day. So that's really, we need to get back to more of a natural lifestyle, and also, you know, people have to vote. We were the best country in the world, you know, and, you know, we were socialists or whatever, and we can get back to being that again. Thank you.